I'm good to let everyone in once you guys are ready.
Okay, I am ready. Thank you all for being here. I'm really excited. I think we're gonna have a great conversation. If you guys need to step aside or anything, please feel free to do so. And you know, we'll just have a good time. And of course, safe space above anything. So thank you all for being here. And I'm really just excited for this conversation, and we'll get started now.
Just like a star across my sky, just like an angel of the rain.
Hello, everyone. Happy Wednesday. Happy Honest Hour Wednesday in particular. Just give it a few moments as everyone hops on in. But thank you for being here today. We're going to have an amazing conversation on AAPI mental health. And I'm so happy that you are here. Please say hello to one another in our chat room. If you'd like to also rename yourself to put your pronouns, please do so. I will also do the same. I'm going to go ahead and add she and hers, because those are my pronouns. Awesome. Yes, Neiman's right. Good evening. It definitely is later in the night, so we're getting into that late night convo. Awesome. If you guys don't know Kareem Bailey Ray, get to know her. This is Like a Star. Beautiful song. Beautiful song. All right, everyone's saying hello. Hello. Hi, Beverly. Welcome. Awesome. All right. Well, let's go ahead and get started. Hello, everyone. My name is Jerica White. I am the College Program Coordinator here at NAMI Orange County. NAMI stands for the National Alliance on Mental Illness. And as a nonprofit organization, what we do is provide mental health support, advocacy, and education to the County of Orange, all at no cost. So that can look like something like Honest Hour or even Happy Hour, where we just promote an hour of wellness, right? And we come together as a community. But at Honest Hour, what we really like to do is just dig deep into these conversations and topics that really don't have much light on it, right? We want to bring more awareness. And with it being May, it is Mental Health Awareness Month. It is also Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month, right? And for me, you know, I've definitely have known more about Black History Month in February, as I am half Black and half Japanese. So it's amazing to have it for both, you know, of my cultures that I resonate with. And so with that being said, we have amazing speakers with us today who we're going to go ahead and meet. But before we jump into that, let's go ahead and do a poll real quick, right? I just want to see how we're feeling right now. Let's just do a quick check-in. No answer is wrong, right? Because this is how you're feeling, and it is absolutely valid. So are we feeling excited, happy, connected, sleepy, nervous, uncertain, hungry? Maybe it's not listed on here. Go ahead and put it in the chat room. And all these answers are anonymous, of course. I'll go ahead and share them at the end. For myself, I would say nervous. I am nervous. I'll probably get hungry once we hit around 8 o'clock, but yeah, and connected as well. I'm excited to be here. Let's give it a few more seconds here. All right, 3, 2, 1. I'm gonna go ahead and close it and share the results here. All right, so we got an even amount between nervous, excited, connected. We got some happy, sleepy, and certain. We're spread out. I love it. But it's the connected for me, right? I love that we're connected. So let's go ahead and just meet everyone first, if that's okay with you all, because I would like for you to see our special guests today before I show a short film. So that being said, I am Jerica White from NAMI Orange County. I am half Black and half Japanese. My mom is full Japanese. And being that, you know, I grew up in SoCal, I've luckily just been able to be immersed in so many cultures, right? Especially being from San Diego. So it's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be here with my fellow AAPI community members. And with that being said, whoever would like to hop on in and introduce themselves, please do so.
Hello, everyone. My name is Michael Chan. I am from the Cambodian Family Community Center, and over there I work as a case manager and health navigator. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you, Neiman. Hi, everyone. My name is Casey. I'm from Free Clinic Project at UCI, and I'm about to graduate this June. I'm Chinese Vietnamese, and recently this senior year, I've been getting more involved in Asian American studies, and I really like getting involved in these conversations in our community as well. I look forward to today. Thank you all for joining us.
Hello, everyone. I'm Neiman. I'm also from Free Clinic Project and UCI. I am a second year psychological science, used to be PSB, and philosophy major. And I am Filipino American. And so I'm also very excited to kind of learn more about you guys and hear more about other stories. I think that's really exciting and really important to have.
Beautiful. Thank you all so much for introducing yourselves. Yes, I didn't mention this earlier, but we are here with amazing mental health organizations. So it's not only NAMI that is here. We also have the Cambodian Family Center here, and Michael is representing them. So we'll be learning more about their resources. And we also have Casey and Neiman here from the Free Clinic Project at UCI, which is my alma mater. So it's amazing just to kind of see how we're all connected and just kind of, you know, building the community together and, of course, bringing mental health resources. So thank you all for introducing one of yourselves. I'm going to go ahead and share the short film. Now, I'm not sure if any of you guys have heard of Art with Impact, but it is an amazing organization that basically they create these movies for mental health, right? And they invite individuals from the community to basically, you know, create the script, right? Do the production, do it all, and they submit it. And from there, they share these films during webinars that they have. And luckily, I've been able to sit on a few of them. And one that really spoke out to me was called The Conversation That Never Happened. It's about 6 minutes. I'm going to go ahead and share it with you all. So I'm going to share my screen here. If you can't hear it, please let me know. We should be able to have full audio. Let me put this up.
Mom. 你看陈阿姨的儿子，他学习每天到十二点钟以后啊，要不然他学的到医生了。我知道陈阿姨的儿子，他一定要学习这么用功才进得了医学院。你知道我最近成绩不太好，成绩不好，那你早点告诉我啊，我们可以请tutor。你知道陈阿姨的儿子以前一直都是有tutor帮，那个tutor也特别好。你可不可以不要？
讲陈阿姨了，我是你的儿子。Brian，妈妈都是为了你好啊。你现在好好学习，以后才能考上好大学，才能有好工作。你怎么不行了呢？每个人都有困难，都要经历这个阶段。你已经够轻松的了，你知道妈妈以前有多艰苦吗？ 你只考虑一个读书的事情，什么都不需要考虑。为什么不能专心？我不知道为什么。我在学校，我不能
concentrate. I have nightmares that I'm not going to do well in school, that I'm not going to get into the university you want me to get into. And you know what hurts the most? All you ever ask about is school and my grades. When was the last time you asked me how I was doing? I sense this fear building every time you ask me about school, about, you know, when you talk about going to university, as if I don't already know. I just feel like, what's the point of it all? What's the point of living? I don't know why I feel this way. I feel alone.
You are not alone. No one
I feel like I don't want to be here.
Brian, 看到你这样子，妈妈心都碎了。妈妈没有失望啊。妈妈是 proud of you。妈妈这些年拼命工作，想给你最好的生活。我是经历很多困难，吃过很多苦的。你知道吗？那些时候啊，真的没有人在旁边安慰，没有人帮助。唉，我还记得那个无助的感觉。可是你现在有妈妈，有什么困难我们一起面对，好不好？妈妈爱你，妈妈就想你好。如果我帮不了你的话，我们找人帮你，好不好？
What are we thinking? What are we thinking? I'm interested to see what the attendees are thinking. Feel free to drop it in the chat room. But what are you guys thinking right off the bat? Anyone want to go first? I could also go, but I would love to see what you guys are thinking.
I can really relate to the child just with, you know, the parents wanting you to do well in school and so you can go to get a good job, and them saying that I had it worse than you, but at the same time that's subjective, because we can never know what it was for them. My parents went through a genocide, and we can never know what it was for them to go through that. But at the same time, we have our own struggles. So they shouldn't be judging us for those struggles, because everybody's struggle is different. And at the same time, I understand where they're coming from, because if you think about like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and the bottom is like basic needs and food, clothing, shelter. So that's what they're worried about. And but over here in the United States, we have the opportunity to rise above those things and move up higher on the hierarchy. So, but I feel like my parents are still in that survivor mentality of, do you have the food, clothing, shelter? And so they can't think about, how are you feeling? What are your emotions like? What are you thinking? Because they're just not there yet.
I like that. I like how you brought in the survivor mentality, right? Because I feel like maybe we only have a lick of that, or it's to the person, to each person, right? And then the objectivity, of course, of I have it worse than you, or you have it worse than me, right? Because I know even talking with my parents, they're like, oh, I can't imagine growing up with like social media. And I'm like, yeah, y'all had it good. But it's like, really? You know, like there always comes that level of perspective. So that's why it's important just to check in, whether you can agree, you can relate or not. It's important to check in. I like how they put in the end for parents to check in with their child, because aside from studies, there's a lot of other things going on. And so What did you think about it, Casey?
I really liked how Michael mentioned, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I definitely see that. And having you say that, it really put it together for me. But what stuck out to me the most from this video was it's the conversation that never happened. But even though I've had the conversation, it feels as though it never happened. So I've probably gone through this conversation every couple years or so in my life, but it constantly feels as though it hasn't. And I definitely feel at the end where they mention the culture of shame or guilt, it's so deeply ingrained that it's really hard to just get out of it or try to dismantle that. So this message was very strong, very powerful.
Thank you. And Vianne, what do you think?
Yeah, I love what everyone's saying so far. And I think it's strange. I think in at least, you know, I can only speak for myself. But you know, it's very interesting because in my own life, it's sort of the, I don't want to say opposite direction, that it sounds really weird to say that, but for me, my parents were very understanding, and I think I was very blessed to have such understanding parents. And I think me being a, you know, second, you know, generation, you know, child here in America, I think I kind of felt, you know, like, because both of my parents, you know, grew up in you know, rural Philippines. And so, you know, and I felt really blessed that they didn't really kind of use the, you know, oh, I, you know, had it so much worse than you card. And I, growing up, I think, especially as I, you know, went off to college and, you know, started like working and started doing other stuff, only then was I realizing like, oh, dang, like they worked like really, really hard. And I felt pressure on myself to really like live up to that, really, because I just felt so inspired. And I think it's sort of a struggle that I find myself kind of thinking about every day of like, am I living up to that? And should I? Yeah, not should I, but in the sense that since my parents don't really expect that of me, since they're very understanding, I like, it's something I struggle with a lot, but.
Thank you for saying that. Yeah, it's really interesting how it depends on the family, right? And I like how you're saying how you've kind of noticed that change now, in the sense of they didn't put that pressure on you of, you know, you have it so good now, right? But then it always makes me think, of course, they always have the best intention for us, right? And they're just speaking from their own experiences, and they just kind of want us to avoid whatever obstacle they had to, you know, kind of come over, whatever it may be. So I think that, you know, like you were saying, Casey, the stigma and the shame has a lot to do with us not only, you know, kind of not having open discussions about mental health, but even seeking resources. And of course, just there being a lack of resources, right? I know I've spoken to Joanne, who was supposed to join us today from Ocapica, but don't worry, we will go ahead and share her resources at the end. But, you know, I spoke with her and she was talking about the supply and demand of mental health resources for the AAPI community. And when I say that, is there something that kind of pops into your guys' head? Because to me, I felt like it clicked automatically. But so when I say supply and demand, what comes to mind for you all, like right off the bat? And feel free, you know, to jump in.
When I think about supply and demand, I think about the beginning of the pandemic when toilet paper was was hard to find.
Yeah, okay, that's good. I would say for myself, with supply and demand of AAPI mental health, you know, with the shame of mental health, a lot of individuals in the AAPI community don't want to identify as, you know, whatever the label may be, whether that's I have a therapist, you know, I'm seeking, you know, professional help, or maybe you're on medication, right, with a psychiatrist, or maybe you just literally Google searched mental health resources in your community, and you're already feeling shame, right? And unfortunately, that's just what lives within our culture as a whole, and that's where we just kind of have to come together and break it down and have these conversations such as tonight. And so with the supply and demand analogy, being that a lot of Asian Americans or just, you know, the AAPI community tends to just, you know, sit in this shame and stigma, we're not reaching out for those resources. And, you know, providers are seeing that, oh, the Asian American community isn't seeking these resources. So why don't we just focus on other communities, maybe Latinx community or the African-American community, just to kind of build up them because they're showing up, right? And then, you know, me being that I work in mental health, I want to help everyone, especially, you know, those that I identify with. And so it's really just where we have to break down that stigma in our families, right? Whether that's immediate and extending and going further and further. So that's that. I just wanted to bring up that analogy. And then of course that brings in just intergenerational differences, right? So right off the bat, you can think of culture shock. So Neiman, you know, your culture versus the culture your parents grew up in, totally different. So, I mean, it absolutely was a blessing that they were like, well, you know, this isn't the Philippines, but still you should be doing AX, you know, A, B, and C. And so that's awesome. And then you're just striving and doing so well. So that's beautiful. And of course, the generational issues as well, there comes in the differences of finances, right? And that's where also mental health resources comes into play. And so with that being said, why don't we just go ahead and talk a little bit about how do individuals in the community connect with your guys' resources? And at first, do you see any hesitation? Or just kind of like, do you kind of have to warm them up? How does that look? And to add to that question, does it look different for maybe a young adult versus someone in their 50s that is maybe seeking help for maybe themselves, maybe like their child? You know, maybe they're more adamant for services for their child versus themselves. What does that look like?
So just as a clarification, you're asking broadly speaking, right? Just for anyone?
Well, maybe more so of on average, you know, do most adults that engage with your resources tend to be hesitant at first because of the shame and stigma? Or they're kind of just like, oh, you know, what do you have? And then they're just kind of all ready for it. What have you noticed?
Yes, definitely. So at our free clinic in Garden Grove, our patients are mainly Spanish-speaking Vietnamese immigrant populations. And what we see or what is common is usually they come in for one physical ailment or illness to get checked out by the physician. But as they go along with the diagnosis process, they realize that there's a comorbidity often with a mental health problem such as depression or anxiety, and how those two illnesses really interact with one another and impact and can either have like a positive or negative effect. And oftentimes that goes overlooked unless we actively, you know, seek it out. So once we do attempt to diagnose them, then we'll also refer them out to other services as well. And we try to keep follow-ups on them, but often there is hesitancy to really, so we give them pharmacy and, you know, of course they'll take the medicine right away. They'll go to the pharmacy, get the medicine, but there's more of a hesitancy to book an appointment for mental health, professional help, and et cetera. So we definitely notice a little hesitancy in the middle, older age generations.
Okay, thank you. What about you, Michael?
Yeah, here at the Cambodian family, we mostly serve older adults, although we do have a smaller youth program, and there definitely is a huge stigma around therapy, and it's really hard to find a Cambodian or Khmer-speaking therapist, which we only have one, and I'm not fluent in Cambodian or Khmer, so unfortunately I cannot provide those services adequately. But it's just a huge stigma, even though we might have people working in mental health. There's also the stigma of themselves being not strong enough to admit to that they need services as well. Lots of hesitancy and just a lot of shame around it. Not wanting to quote unquote ruin the reputation of the family by admitting that. So there's just so many myths to the spell about having a mental illness.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, that was well put, thank you. And I'm thinking from with both of your kind of interactions with the community, it seems like the individuals are more interested in, I wouldn't say a quick fix, but something that you can kind of sweep under the rug, right? I can take my medication, but I'm not going to go to the therapist and talk to them about what I'm going through, right? Which also makes me think of the privacy that AAPI community or, you know, individuals like to keep, right? Definitely like to keep to ourselves. We don't want to be, I know my mom does not want to be on social media, you know, to kind of keep my life the way it is, private, under the wraps. And I respect that. I love it. But I think that that also just kind of goes to show with, like you were saying, Michael, the reputation, you know, no, we're doing well. Don't worry. We're, you know, my son's studying, right? We're doing good. No worries. We're doing just like everyone else is. And that's it. You know, there's nothing to complain about. We're here in America, you know, we're doing the best that we can. And the thing about it though, is not every day is a good day. Right. And as a child, like, you know, we see that, and we're aware of it, but without our parents talking about it, you know, what resources can we reach out to, you know, and we even want to give the resources to our parents as well. So I think that it's amazing that you guys, you know, you even follow up and you're just kind of like, okay, how did that go? Right. And just kind of trying to see, you know, ways to engage with them. But like you're saying with the hesitancy, I'm wondering how can we, I would love to eliminate the hesitancy, but I would even say for myself, I'm even hesitant for some mental health resources, right? You know, there's that uncomfort or just the idea of there being a change or a shift in something, right? You feel a little uncomfort, and that's okay. But with that, I'm wondering how can we kind of diminish that or minimize it, you know, with either, you know, the younger generations or even those that you're kind of working with in the 30s and 40 ranges. How do we get them to kind of be more all in a way? How do we do that?
I wanted to piggyback on what you said. It again reminds me of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, because our clients are not hesitant at all to get health services, whether they need to make a doctor's appointment or get some translation for something that a service that they need. But once we bridge that gap and build a rapport with them through those other services, then we can start beginning to provide and offer them mental health services. But right off the bat, they're not going to be willing to get the mental health services. And I think a very important part is using stigma-free language, and saying, you know, using language that doesn't define a person as by their mental illness, but using language that shows that it's just one part of them and not the whole of who they are. So I think that's one way that we can start with, you know, what am I saying here?
Just to make them a little less hesitant, right? Maybe.
Less hesitant. Yeah.
Well, I like that. I love that. Because labeling definitely comes in with shame, right? So just kind of building them up and saying it's a part of you, and you can live with it, and you're not the only one. No, that's a great step, Michael. I think we're already working on it. We're already kind of diminishing the hesitancy. What else? What does the Free Clinic Project have in mind? I want to see what you guys got.
Yeah, I know. Maybe Casey can speak more to specifically like what Free Clinic can do. But I think just with thinking about my own personal experience of reducing that hesitancy, I think borrowing what Michael said about changing the language we use and changing the labeling that we do use to stigmatize mental health, I think I think it's especially important to also start young. And I know I sound like an old man who's like, you should start young and, you know, do all that. But I think back on like my own like experiences, like in elementary school. And I think back about, like, for example, like we had DARE. I think DARE is still going on in some places. But like, you know, like we had DARE and we had like, you know, PE and all this stuff. But I don't ever remember having like a meditation session or like something about like, you know, mental health or like talking about, because, you know, we talked about like, you know, oh, you should, you know, eat healthy and do all these things, but they like never talked about like how to maintain a you know, good mental health. And so I think especially like in the earlier years, combining that with changing the language we use to describe mental illness, I think is a huge step forward in destigmatizing it and reducing that hesitancy that we talked about.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yes, and that just made me think real quick before we go to you, Casey, of bullying. I mean, that happens on campuses all the time in many forms. So imagine, you know, a student just being, maybe unfortunately, you know, they were just in a really uncomfortable encounter, stepping away and just mindfully breathing. Are you kidding me? Or like, let me just mindfully eat my lunch. I would be like, yes, I would love that. That would make, you know, I'm sorry, you know, whatever, what they went through, but just to be able to find a better way to kind of cope with that, right? And then maybe just even influencing their friends to do so. That's beautiful. Yes. Yes, that's a great one. That's a great one. So we're changing the you know, we're having a stigma-free language, but we're also starting them young, right? Having these conversations. Casey, what about you? Any ideas?
Yeah, I actually wanted to add on to what you were just mentioning. This is because I'm an education major at UCI, and what schools are trying to do is actually implement more social emotional wellness and moral development type of into the curriculum, and it has great effects because it definitely lets kids and reassures kids that it's okay to be vulnerable. And I think we can translate that to the older generations as well. Just reassuring them that it's all right to be vulnerable. You are safe here, you know, as well. And changing the language along with that vulnerability. And that leads to something else that I thought of, but it's also linguistic barriers. I think Michael also mentioned it. Linguistic barriers makes it a little difficult. I know that speaking to older generations, sometimes they might even say, mental health isn't real, or there's no such word like that in our language even. So it's, how can we help them understand when it's something that's really not within their culture? So it's definitely just breaking it down slowly, reassuring them that vulnerability is okay and mental health is real, and it does, you know, actually affect our mental well-being as well as our physical health at times.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And with vulnerability, we're able to kind of explore what resources we have and ask those questions. Yes. Oh, wonderful. I love this. Okay. So I know we were also kind of discussing, you know, reputation. And of course, the conversation of the model minority myth comes into play, right? And I think that this definitely has come up, especially in this time of, you know, all the protests, right, with Black Lives Matters. And then of course, now we have Stop Asian Hate, right? And to be honest with you guys, I'm getting hit left and right. It's just like, oh, all right, how can I support my community? Oh, okay, how can I support my community? And you know, it's awesome being an advocate, but there are the times where I just kind of have to check in with myself too, right? And so with the model minority myth, you know, I could even see it kind of within my own family, right? Or even with myself individually, of the extent of me showing up more so for my black community, right? And then when Stop Asian Hate came about, the posts about it, you know, the footage you see, it wasn't to the extent of Black Lives Matters, right? And one is being that, unfortunately, the AAPI community, we're not supposed to really complain, right? Even though our elders are literally getting assaulted, right? And it is so disheartening. And so with that being said, I would like to know personally, do you guys feel that you have ever maybe fell through into the model minority myth, whether that be on campus or maybe, you know, in a space where you maybe were just kind of more of a bystander, right? And if it's too personal, we could totally skip over it. But I'm just wondering how have you guys kind of experienced that? And are you kind of stepping out of it, right? Because at the end of the day, the AAPI community is a minority. We are minorities, but the myth has caused us to act in different ways where we're not standing up for others in our community, within the minority community. So what do you guys think of that? I'm curious.
Oh yeah, so in my Asian American classes, we talk about this a lot. We read the history about it and how the model minority myth holds the AAPI to this monolithic type of success standard in America. And, you know, in reality, we're very heterogeneous. There's all different types of AAPI ethnicities, as well as not everybody can be held to those standards. And often growing up in Southern Orange County, where I am the minority, I definitely feel myself being held to those standards, even the most basic ones, such as being good at math. But if I'm good at it, then my teachers invalidate it, it's expected. But if I'm bad at it, then I'm criticized for it. So it really does affect us in real ways. It seems pretty lighthearted at times, the jokes or like the Asian nerds on TV. That's in media, it's represented, you know, also as like one standard as well. So it really does have impacts on students as well as, you know, working professionals.
Thank you for sharing that. Michael, go ahead.
Yeah, I think the model minority effect or what have you is really detrimental. It's just very high and impossible standards to meet. And you may be already getting messages from your parents that you're not enough. And then you're also getting messages from society that you're not enough, because they might compare you from one Asian to another. But like Casey said, there's so many different types of Asian people that, you know, what might be good for one person might not be good enough for another. And in reality, there are a lot of Asian Americans living in poverty or not being able to obtain education and not being able to reach those high standards. So that can lead to thoughts of suicide and other, you know, depression, anxiety, and other mental illnesses.
Yes, absolutely.
Sorry, the lights went out. So really quick tangent. My light switch is powered by motion and it's in a weird corner of the room. It turns off every 30 minutes. So that's what happened there. Anyway, in response to a model minority myth, right? Speaking from my own experience, I think it definitely, for me at least, I very vividly remember my junior year. I, you know, was, you know, starting to take these APs and whatnot. And I remember that year, like the year before, I remember talking with all of my friends. They were like, oh, Neiman, you know, like, what classes are you taking and whatnot? And I remember them, I remember me specifically saying, because at our school, like, you took like Lang, like junior year, I think. And I remember telling people like, oh yeah, I'm not taking like, you know, AP Calc or AP Lang or any of these. I was only taking one AP my junior year. And then I remember people being like, oh, yeah, aren't you supposed to like be like, you know, you're Asian, so you're supposed to. And I was just so like taken aback. And like, obviously at the time, you know, I knew it would like, it was just like misinformed, but you know, at the, it was very, it was something I really thought about a lot, and I think really affected me my junior year. And seeing the difference between the types of people in like the AP in AP classes and like the regular classes that I took, I think was just such a huge gap. And I think it was really like very heavily stigmatized. And I, you know, it was just a, you know, a huge gap of worlds between, you know, when I took my actual first AP class and when I, you know, was in my my other classes. It was just, it was so like the air was so different. And I felt like, you know, in one setting I was and this is just my own experience, but in one setting I felt like, you know, I was kind of like at the bottom, and in another setting it felt like everyone kind of felt like they were, you know, at the top or whatever. And it was just, and combining that with, you know, like the stigmas of like, oh, you know, you're supposed to be good at math and, you know, do all these things, it was a really, really confusing for me, I think, is the big takeaway of that. So
yeah. No, thank you all for sharing. And I would say, you know, we definitely experience it differently depending on where we are, right? So that could be on campus. I know for myself being at UCI, it's about what, 68% Asian, I think, AAPI community, right? So with that being said, you know, I thought I would just immerse in, no problem. But if you look at me right off the bat, you think, oh, she's Black, you know, and I am, I'm a half Black. And so being at UCI, unfortunately, I kind of didn't really fit in any group because I wasn't Asian enough. And I wasn't Black enough, right? And that's a whole nother thing too. But then of course, there's of course the privilege of me being a lighter skin, you know, with colorism and things like that. And the same thing with the AAPI community, right? Filipinos tend to have darker skin tones than maybe a Korean individual would, right? And so in that case too, where does the model minority myth fall, right? Things like that. So thank you guys for breaking that down with us. And we do have some community questions that I wanted to share with us before we kind of jump into our larger Q&A. These were submitted through email and Instagram. And so before I jump into these, is there anything that you guys wanted to bring up? Any topics, anything I haven't covered yet? Because I know this is such a broad topic and really we could talk for hours, but is there anything that I'm missing? Anything that you would like to really share with our attendees today? All right, now, if it comes up, just let us know. It's no problem. Okay, awesome. So here's the first question. So mental illness is a taboo topic in my family. What do I do when my parents view depression as a weakness? And I'm going to go ahead and repeat these questions, type the questions in here just so you guys can see it as well. I'll repeat it again. So, mental illness is a taboo topic in my family. What do I do when my parents view depression as a weakness? And I think this kind of even, you know, kind of goes back to that short film that we saw, right? Of where he was just telling her, like, I'm not doing well. And she's like, no, but like, it's because of your phone. And I know we've heard that so many times. I've heard that so many times. Like, how do you know the lyrics to all these songs? I'm like, well, I listen to it from front to end all the time, you know, but it's not just the phone, right? It's deeper than that. And that's why we kind of have to ask those questions. How would this individual start that conversation, even though their parents may see them as weak? How could they approach that?
Well, I do want to say that it's not easy. It's not easy at all. If you can get support from people at your school, your peers, your teachers, maybe there's a school counselor that you can go to, or find a trusted mentor to speak with. Unfortunately, in some families, being depressed is being seen as lazy, overall, it may be just a symptom of something bigger. They may see as lazy, but you may be so depressed that you can't get up from your bed, and you lost interest in activities, and you know, it's a really hard question to answer. For me personally, when I got of age and decided enough was enough, I decided to go seek out my own therapy, it definitely changed the world for me, but it wasn't like, you know, overnight. You take it one day at a time. And I don't know. I'm just gonna leave it as I don't know what to say. If for some families, it's really hard, and they could really you know, make you feel ashamed for seeking out help because of how it's going to reflect on them. But all I can say is be strong and don't give up, and seek out all the help and support that you can get. Know that you're not weak for seeking help. You're strong for seeking help, because the first step is to recognize that you do need help. So, and from there you can improve your life in so many ways. So I'm not sure what the other panelists think. So I'm curious to.
Yeah, no, that was really great, Michael. I think you really summed up a lot of at least what I was gonna say. Yeah, and I also really want to emphasize and reiterate that point you mentioned about how hard it is and how difficult it is to start that conversation, and how, especially, you know, again going back to the subjectiveness of our experiences, you know, growing up, either, you know, us, you know, here in America, or, you know, as our parents, you know, in whichever country they immigrated from. And so it's so difficult to find that middle ground, I think. And I think one point I think you mentioned, Michael, that I personally would advocate for is finding those mentors and finding those strong social networks to help support you in your, you know, encouraging those conversations with your parents. Since I think, you know, at least in my own life, I have found a lot of mentors who have been so helpful, not only as, you know, like whether they were my teacher or my coach or my drama, you know, coach or whatever, you know, they were all so helpful in not only just like, you know, learning about, you know, whatever the activity was, but also just like life advice and like teaching me, you know, like how to like make a resume, for example. I know that's not like the topic of this conversation, but, you know, it's sort of, you know, finding those mentors that really care about you, I think is so, it's so worth their time. And even if you just like remotely, like, you know, a professor or a teacher, you know, reach out to them, you know, start a conversation with them maybe, and then maybe down the road, they can help you engage in conversations with your parents. Or perhaps other relatives that might be facing or harboring those stigmatizations against mental illness as well. And so really having that strong social network and friends as well, obviously. Friends are very important to help you, support you in your endeavors. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I definitely agree with what Neiman and Michael have been saying. The way I thought of it is how most AAPI cultures are collectivist cultures. So it's more of like the family is a unit. Whatever you do, it reflects on the family and vice versa. So when they believe that depression is a weakness, they don't want that to be seen as their weakness as well, because they might vicariously be living through us, the second gen, because their job was to come over here. And now our job is to, you know, be better and live, you know, a higher standard of quality of life. And so it's a lot of pressure. And I think, as Michael mentioned, it is just very difficult. And in my own experiences, the best thing to do is just slowly start establishing myself as an individual in my parents' eyes, like an individual with my own feelings, my own experiences, and kind of not separating from the family, but making it known that it's not like a family type of, I forgot the word. Yeah, I'm not representing the family like in that certain way. Rather, it's more like I'm seeking out help for myself, and it goes along with just setting more personal boundaries. I think a lot of Asian families can be very close-knit, tight, and you kind of lose your sense of self there. What has worked for me on campus, I've actually had a couple professors invalidate my experiences. And so I've kind of strayed away from that, but I've found a really good group of friends, very small though, but we basically have like oldest daughter of an immigrant family support group. And I think it's so nice to be able to talk to people who really understand what you're going through, because I can talk as much as I want with other people, but they just will not get the exact type of feelings that we feel, you know, really holding our families together. So.
Thank you. Thank you. Such great insight. First of all, Casey, I would like to say, you said you were the oldest sibling out of your family. It was Mother's Day. You are just as much of a mother of taking care of your siblings. So thank you so much for all that you've done, you know, especially, right, being here. And then, you know, you obviously want them to, you know, feel validated and things like that. So shout out to moms and shout out to you, Casey. but I want to go ahead and drop these notes down. So this is what I gathered from what the panelists have said. So first, you're showing strength by reaching out, right? Maybe find a trusted mentor to speak with. So, you know, even with the initial question, you want to, you know, let your parents know of your depression or whatever mental health condition you may have. Even if they don't fully grasp it or get it, there is someone else there that will be there to listen to you, that will have the answers for you and resources. So, you know, just don't end there. Maybe it's more so of you letting them know and then being aware of, okay, maybe they'll be, you know, kind of going through different medications. So just kind of keep an eye out, right? Things like that. But no, we don't need their approval, right? Just kind of like Casey was saying, and in a sense, I know we're within the AAPI community, it's definitely collectivist, right? But we live in America where it's completely individualistic. So it's just kind of like that flip-flop of you know, that cultural difference as well. So at the end of the day, you know, we're really trying to prioritize our personal well-being, you know, and with that being said, we just have to maybe take those sacrifices, right? Maybe you may need a time just for yourself, and that's totally okay, because then you can come back and maybe educate your family on what resources you have or things like that. So that was a beautiful question. Okay. And then I see, Diego, that you had a question that you would like to ask, and I know that we may have additional attendees that would like to ask questions. Please feel free to go ahead and submit them privately, just because we want to keep it everyone's, you know, personal questions with some security. So with that being said, I'm going to change the chat settings to host only. So we'll all be able to see your question, but feel free to go ahead and submit those, guys. Okay, and then coming up, how can I stop feeling like my mental illness is embarrassing or a burden? I think this kind of adds on to the question of having to live up to the pressure of being an Asian American, right? So like getting good grades, right? Becoming a doctor, things, these stereotypes, right? And unfortunately with that stress, they're not really sure how to deal with it, because what if they aren't as successful as they're supposed to be, right? Especially if their parents, just came over here, and then, you know, they're immigrants, and they're just kind of putting all their eggs in one basket for their child, but their child may have depression or may not want to, they want to do art, right? Or, you know, maybe it's totally different. So with that being said, how can I feel that my mental illness is not a burden on my family? And even for myself, I wouldn't find embarrassment through that, through whatever the mental health condition may be. I think I'm going to have to kind of borrow a little bit of what Michael said earlier, in the sense of just kind of coming to terms with, you know, whatever it may be. And then from there, accepting it, right? You know, it's a part of me. Right. But I can still, you know, function and make friends. Maybe my routine is different, but that's okay, because no person is the same, but I'm also not alone in this. Right. And then you can build a community out of that. It's like Casey was saying, and it may not be through the school, but maybe something that you even build on yourself. Right. And with the pressure of being a typical Asian American individual, what does that even look like? That's my question, right? What are we really striving for? I don't know what that model is, because to me, it's not working, right? We need to engage. We need to ask these questions and to be vulnerable. That's the main thing I would say. And in that, like Mike was saying, there's strength in that. Like, I don't see any weakness in that. I'm just like, oh yes. Okay. You had a bad day and you want to figure out what that trigger was. Let's do it. Right. You know, whatever it may be. So, I'm just talking off now. So whoever would like to answer that question, I'm going to go ahead and type it in here as well, so everyone can see.
Absolutely. Oh, sorry. Okay. To add on to what you were saying about how you and Mike were saying it takes a lot of strength, it absolutely does. And I just want to reassure, you know, these individuals that it takes so much courage and vulnerability to be able to make those difficult decisions. It really does take a lot of effort and energy, mental and physical. But at the end, I hope that, you know, you do make decisions for yourself, prioritize yourself and well-being first. And you might not hurt others, but others might, how do I say, because you might be somebody that they rely on, and then you have to choose yourself once in a while, other people might be ending up feeling the burden, but I want to reassure them that it's definitely not because of you. You should not be ashamed or embarrassed about your situation, but it's really necessary for you to put yourself first sometimes, because how can you help others when you cannot help yourself? And in my moral development class, somebody put it very, instead of being selfish or too selfless, because that can be harmful as well, it's important to be self-full. So not full of yourself, but preserve enough energy, put yourself first, invest in yourself so that you have enough energy to care for others in a healthy way.
Yeah, that was a really good summary of actually what I was going to say, Casey. So kudos to you. But yeah, I guess I'll add on to what you said, Casey, and really what everyone is kind of touching on here. I think Jerrica, earlier you said something about approval, and I think that's something that's really helped me personally. And obviously, I can't speak for everyone, but you know, something that's really helped me. Kind of, you know, reconciled with myself is really just accepting that, you know, really my life is my own life and other people need to remember that, especially, you know, family members who might, you know, want to intervene. And I know it's obviously well-intentioned because they want the best for me. But at the end of the day, you have to remember that it is your own life. And at the end of the day, what really matters is if you're happy. And when you're happy, like Casey said, you know, you have to put on your own oxygen mask before you can help, you know, put the oxygen mask on others. And so you can't help your family, for example, be happy if you're not happy yourself. And I think it's really important to remember that. You should always remember that whenever you're thinking about your own mental struggles and thinking about destigmatizing, I guess, your own mental struggles. Since I know, you know, it can, as many people have mentioned, it is very difficult to really, and a lot of times feels really embarrassing to, you know, have mental struggles. And I think just remembering that, you know, you don't need to you don't need to take it from anyone. You know, you're here for yourself, and you know, you should. You know, you should allow help when, you know, others are helping or trying to help, obviously. And you should, you know, help others when you can. But you have to remember that, you know, it's really important to look out for yourself. And always remember that you only need your own approval to be happy in life. You don't need anyone else's approval. Since you can only get other people's approval once you approve of yourself, right? So.
Yeah, I would have to agree with Casey and Neiman. I would have to say, please, as much as you can. I know it's easier said than done. Get the help sooner rather than later. Push through the difficult conversation, the conversation that you don't want to have. Because the sooner you can get help, the more you can prevent things from happening, and don't want to get to the point of having suicidal ideation. So please do not carry the burden on your own. Rather be okay with your family carrying that burden. But I wouldn't even say that your family is a burden being burdened by you. They're here to support you. And yeah, just reflecting on the collectivistic family thing is the analogy of the oxygen mask and the analogy, you know, of if your cup is empty and doesn't have any water in it, then how can you put any water into anybody else's cup? You have to be able to fill up your cup first. So please, I beg and urge you to take care of your mental health first, lest it gets worse. So otherwise, if you think about that, it would be even a bigger burden on your family if you had to, you know, go to call 911 and get emergency help like that. So at some point, basically what I'm saying is, at some point, if you wait too long, then it might just explode and your family might be quote unquote exposed anyway. So you can prevent that from happening.
Awesome. Thank you guys. That was such great tips. I also left some notes here. So I added, invest in yourself, seek your own approval, reach out for resources sooner rather than later. And you don't have to carry the burden on your own, right? And I like how you said that, Michael. It's not a burden. And that kind of goes back to just the language use, right? We definitely want to use stigma-free language. So maybe even just kind of reflecting back on yourself of not seeing yourself as a burden, or the mental health condition that you're dealing with. It's not a burden. It's something, a part of you that you can kind of deal with. But at the same time, that is not for me to say that it's not a burden to you, because that you is totally valid however you feel. But I want to let you know that I don't see you any differently, you know? So, you know, if there's resources that we can help you with, please let us know. And then for this last question that I have on here, it says, I'm biracial and sometimes my mom's side of the family makes me feel like I don't quite fit in. How do I get them to accept me? So right off the bat, I'm thinking, honestly, the tips that we just put at the top that we just, you know, discussed would fit perfectly for that. It would fit seamlessly, to the extent of just investing in yourself, right? Or maybe even exploring your cultures on your own time. And then from there, seeing what resonates with you, asking questions, right? I remember my first year of UCI, I took an AFAM class, and African American Studies class, and we learned about Kwanzaa, and I've never learned about Kwanzaa before. And I called my dad, I'm like, Dad, we're celebrating Kwanzaa. And he's like, I mean, okay, if you want to, like, you know, we haven't really talked about it, but that's just for me to, you know, dig deeper into it. Because there's even things that our family doesn't talk about, like we're saying here, right? And so that's where we bring up those conversations. And even if there's uncomfort in it, at the end of the day, it's something that you wanted to talk about, and that is totally valid. So I think bringing that to the table is good. And even if your parents or your family members don't fully understand, you know, and like Casey, you were saying, at times you kind of have to repeat the same conversation, right? You know, we're just going to be hopeful that one day it clicks. But if anything, it's more reassuring for yourself, right? I don't want to speak for you, Casey, but it's kind of like when you teach someone a math problem or something, you understand it better because you taught it to them and you're showing them. And, you know, maybe they ask a question you never thought of. So I think that's how I would answer that for sure. In the sense of, how do I get them to accept me? Maybe even more so of just accept yourself, right? And then I'll throw in one more quick anecdote. I know growing up, my brother and I, we would visit our family in Japan, and you know, they tend to travel a lot in public transportation. So on the buses, on trains, and sitting on the trains, everyone is staring at my brother and I. So it's me and my brother, you know, little caramel babies with my mom, who's Japanese. And it's just everyone staring at us. And it got to a point where I literally bought sunglasses because I wanted to stare back. And I know that, you know, as a kid, like, we shouldn't be staring, but I was just like, no, I want to see them look at me. So I'm just sitting there and I'm just like, so I'm obviously standing out, you know, but within that trip, I found pride in it. You know, because for one, I had my brother with me. And for individuals that may not have a sibling or close enough relationship, you know, that for me, that was a good way for me to accept myself, is because I'm not the only one. So having those relationships and just kind of seeing that you are not alone, I would say definitely enables me to feel more powerful, you know. But what tips do you guys have? Of course, Casey, that's what I'm here for.
Yeah, I would definitely say it starts with yourself. It starts with self-love and the messages and the stories that you tell yourself. Only you at the end of the day can be your own personal quote unquote bodyguard or like protector against the negative energy that other people may throw towards you. I definitely felt like I never fit in being Asian and American. When my cousins came from Cambodia, you know, I was either too American for them or not. And then I wouldn't be Asian enough. But then I grew up in a mostly white community, so I didn't fit in there either, because obviously I didn't look like them. So it's very hard. And then my parents, they own a business where the population is Hispanic, Latinx, and Black. So over there, I just get stared at all the time as well. So it's pushing past the discomfort, and it starts with education and dispelling those myths, letting them know that you're just a human being, just like them. So we're all struggling in this together and trying to get through it.
Beautiful. Neeman and Casey, did you guys have anything to add to that?
Yeah. I guess I'll just add something really quick. Michael, thank you so much for sharing your story on that. And I think it's I feel pretty similarly, especially what you mentioned about like the cousins. And I see Casey nodding, so I'm sure you've had some similar experiences of like the cousins coming over, and then, you know, when you come over, like you know you don't feel like Asian enough to like relate to them. And I remember, because I went on a trip probably 3 years ago now to the Philippines for a family reunion, and I remember like my brother and I, you know, my sister can understand Tagalog, which is the language in the Philippines. But my brother and I, you know, grew up here, like in America. And so we don't know like any Tagalog. And so when we were there, it was so, we both felt so bad, because like everyone there could understand English, but like we couldn't like understand, like reciprocate like in Tagalog. So we felt so bad, and we didn't really feel, you know, like Michael mentioned, we didn't feel like Asian enough to really relate on the same level. And then similarly, like for example, in my own personal life, like I did a lot of theater in high school, which is like very, and like at least in my high school, is very predominantly white. And so I didn't really feel as accepted there either, since, you know, it wasn't a very Asian dominant theater department there. And so I felt there wasn't really like someone for me to turn to whenever I had any, you know, mental struggles, you know, doing theater, since, you know, I was, you know, one of the very few. So.
Thank you for saying that. Yeah, man, you guys are like, honestly, this whole conversation has been sparking so many things and like memories in my head. But I like how you brought in just kind of like that language barrier, right? You know, for me personally, it's interesting. I can understand Japanese, but I can't speak it. So my cousin, she understands English, but she can't speak it. So she'll speak to me in Japanese and I'll speak to her in English. And it's just like, it works, right? And so that's why, you know, there really is no structure to it, right? I feel like we could we can figure out a way to communicate and to let one another, just to kind of bring more awareness and to educate one another. But like Michael was saying, unfortunately, with us having a small amount of resources for the AAPI community and a lot of, you know, the professionals in there not, you know, fully being able to speak these languages, it's really hard to it's really hard to fully connect, right? And so hopefully, you know, by you guys kind of being here and us having these conversations and, you know, connecting with our community, we'll be able to build more resources, right? We'll be able to have more individuals going out there, getting their licenses, connecting with individuals and you know, just kind of building them up. And I think that's amazing. So I'm gonna go ahead and drop these notes in here too. But beautiful, beautiful. And it's amazing because at the end of the day, America is just a melting pot of so many cultures, right? It's just a mixing pot. So I think it's amazing just to kind of connect and show up for one another. And now, do we have any questions that were submitted, Amanda? I haven't seen any on my end, but I do have some of my own. Let's see. Amanda just put it there too. Okay. Well, honestly, I have a fun question, but first I want to ask Casey first. So, you know, we've been working in mental health and everything, and you work in education, or you're getting your degree in education. And so with that being said, I know at times, women or individuals that identify as female tend to show up, right? And I am so happy that we have Neiman and Michael here with us, because it's literally split two and two, right? And at times you'll see five girls or and maybe one guy. So I'm just so happy that you guys are here to show up and to show not only the AAPI community that, you know, you're here to support and that you're an advocate, but also that you are identifying as a male here and supporting, right? You've used resources. You are an advocate. So Casey, I'm curious, how does that make you feel? And then I want to give them the floor.
Absolutely. This is actually a very personal issue of mine. So one of my previous partners was diagnosed with depression, and he went through a really tough time in our like beginning years of college. So it was definitely difficult to see him struggling and see the way his friend group around him reacted to it, because it wasn't as like supportive as I knew my friends would be. And it was really hard because I really wanted him to have that strong support group or just people that, you know, were there for him. But at the end of the day, you know, all he said was like, oh, you know, nobody's going to listen to me. And it was really sad to hear that, honestly. So I'm really glad to see that Neiman and Michael are here, because I really would hope that can change. I think.
Thank you for sharing. Yeah, no, thank you. That says a lot right there, I would say. No, thank you so much. Well, what about the guys? What are you guys saying? Thank you for being here. I'm so happy.
I guess I should be proud, but at the same time, I don't know. I feel like there's a long way to go. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was just seeing the other day a heated topic on this book called Man Enough, and everyone was saying that everyone in the comments were so negative. They were like saying, "Oh, I don't trust this guy. He has a man bun and." Just grow up and just it's called growing up, it's just part of life. But these type of sayings are detrimental to mental health, and saying that he's effeminate because he talks about his mental health, they're just all these negative things got me so heated up in the comments. I'm like, I can't believe these people they're not getting that this is about mental health. It's not about being able to fix a tire on the side of the road. If you get a flat, does not equate to being a man. Yes, it is a helpful skill, but it does not equate to being a man. And other myths like that, it just bothers me. And I think we can just only educate one person at a time. And I can just see how how these men's mental health continue to struggle because of people are not seeing the point. So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. First off, thank you both, Michael and Casey, for sharing that. I think, yeah, it's yeah, definitely weird. I think definitely weird. In that it's, I say weird in the sense that it's something I think about like literally every single day. Just to, you know, like what it. You know, thinking about what it means to be masculine, what it means to be, you know, and thinking about, you know, how all of these different identities intersect. And I think, as Michael mentioned, it's a long road, it's a long journey. I don't think anyone has perfected it, and I don't think anyone ever will. I think it's just something you learn throughout life. And, you know, it's, yeah, I think it's so, you know, in my own experiences, you know, I'm skinny, you know, I'm like 5'4", not exactly, you know, I've got like, you know, this whole hairless situation going on, which I'm very comfortable about. Okay. I think bald is amazing. Okay. I would highly recommend it. Save a lot of money on shampoo, just in case you were thinking about it. So, but I mentioned that because, you know, it's really, you know, thinking about like, you know, I think, without getting too personal, I think, you know, looks has definitely been something I've been very considerate about, you know, especially in my case, since, you know, I'm not exactly, you know, like the peak, you know, male physique or anything like that. And so it's something I think about every day. But, you know, something, you know, really interesting too, is like hearing about like, especially how like guys, you know, in my own friend groups, like handle mental health. And like a lot of times, and I feel like, I don't want to say I've seen it all, but I've seen a lot of different like ways, especially guys like deal with mental health. Cause I know some of them are very like logical and rational to the point where they like dismiss mental illness as just being some like illogical, like, oh, it's just some, you know, like, yeah, I'm just like overthinking it or whatever. And then some other guys are just, you know, like, you know, as people have mentioned, it doesn't exist. And so it's not real and, you know, stuff like that. And then other guys like try to hide it. And what's really interesting is like, even now, like I you know, I have conversations with, you know, some of my friends in high school. And like, it's especially the older ones where I find out like they've been seeing it, and like we're having like casual conversations, and then they would just like casually mention that they've been seeing a therapist like for like, you know, years. And like, and I've like known these people for like, you know, probably, you know, at least like 5 years, and like, I'm only finding out now. And so I think a lot of it comes with, you know, maturation and just, you know, and maturity. And so it's definitely interesting to think about how all of these, you know, especially with the, you know, identifying as an AAPI person and, you know, how that intersects with being, you know, a man. And, you know, it's very, you know, I think I'm kind of rambling at this point, but that's the general sense. I think there's a lot to talk about.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you guys so much. And really, I just did all that just to give you guys props, because there's not enough men within the mental health field. So thank you for showing up and for being here and, you know, literally putting your camera on just to say, I'm here and, you know, I'm still a man, right? Like nothing's changed. I'm living the way that, you know, whatever's thrown at me, I'll figure it out. I know how to cope. I have resources, things like that. Just kind of gliding along, and it may not be smooth, and that's okay. But I don't know, to me, I feel like you guys might be comfortable actually talking about that with people that, you know, with your close knit of other friends or loved ones. And not everyone feels that way, right? And it could be the person who seems like the happiest or the most, maybe the individual that kind of dominates in the conversation, right? That seems like they have it all together and really they don't. So I'd say thank you guys for being here. And also let's check in on all of our friends, y'all, especially in the month of May. Especially our happy friends too. We gotta check in on them. But yeah, let's go ahead and transition to my last question. This is my personal question. I want to know if you guys have your favorite foods within, you know, your kind of like your personal culture here. I love Japanese food right off the bat. I just do. It's my top. I'm going to either have to say sukiyaki. I love a chicken katsudon. chicken calzedon. Like I can eat that up. And then, yeah, I'll probably just have to go with those, but some kind of rice dish, right? Like with the meat on top, you know, some, that those are my favorites. And then I'm going to go ahead and list these two. Okay, Beverly Katsudon, see, I'm going to list these down. So, you know, we give some recommendations for our friends here. Whoever's next, let me see what you think. What's your favorite, I mean? Sukiyaki.
My favorite dish is this Cambodian dish called salamachu. And it's like a sweet and sour dish. It's kind of like the Filipino sinigang, but yeah, it's really good. It has like pineapples. It's like really tropically and sour and sweet and delicious.
Thank you, Michael. Do you actually mind writing down a little description and saying the name in chat room just so people can look back at it? And I don't want
to,
I don't.
Yeah, I'll try to figure out how to spell it.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you.
I'm going to search Google search real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, as we approach summer and like the warm months, my favorite Vietnamese food, or actually it's a dessert, but it's chia thai, and it basically has all of the best tropical fruits and the pandan flavoring and coconut milk all in one little like cup. So I really love it. It's so much fun.
That sounds also colorful. Mm-hmm. That sounds very refreshing. All right, Neiman, I'm already salivating. What's next?
Oh yeah, there's a lot to choose from. I guess if I had to choose one, I think I'm gonna have to say lechon. And for those of you who are unfamiliar, it's basically pork, but it's like the traditionally served way of serving lechon is like having the actual like the whole pig. Like cooked and baked and like there, and then you're the one who like cuts into it and, you know, gets out of it. And I know describing it kind of sounds very unappealing, but it tastes amazing. There's usually like seasoning on it and everything. But I know the way I'm very terrible at describing foods, so I apologize, but I highly encourage it. I'll type it right now. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Great. Okay. So now that we've shared a little bit about our personal stories and, you know, our favorite foods and just kind of giving one another shout outs, I do want to know about your guys' resources. So I know we talked about it a little bit, but in particular too, I know Michael was saying that the Cambodian family centers tends to work with more older adults, right? So not so much the teens and young adults in the community. Yes. Okay. So is there any particular resources that teens and young adults in the community can connect to at the Cambodian Family Center?
Oh, yes. Sorry. I'm trying to get this.
Your favorite food. No problem. No, we need that. We need that information.
Oh. Oh, shoot. Sorry about that.
Okay.
I was trying to find the video of the food. Okay.
Oh, there perfect. We go. Oh, we got a YouTube video. Perfect. Thank
you. How to make it. I'm sorry, what was the question again?
In particular to your resources at the Cambodian Family Center,
yeah.
Do you have any resources for the teens and young adults of this community in particular? I know you said you had a small program. And what does that look like?
Yeah, we actually do have a youth program with after-school tutoring, and then we also provide leadership. We currently have a program called Empowering Southeast Asian and Latinx Youth, but it's open to all youth in Santa Ana, and they can get a $100 gift card for attending a six-week class, and it basically educates them about preventing substance use. So
that's great.
Our program on youth.
Beautiful. Awesome. Thank you, Michael. I know Amanda's going to go ahead and drop these links here for us so that you guys can go ahead and check those out. And now for the Free Clinic Project, what about you guys? Are you guys engaging with teens and young adults? And how does that kind of that process look?
Absolutely. Absolutely, Neiman. Actually, Neiman or Mariah, did you want to talk about CHAMP or SREI?
Sure. And Mariah or Casey, feel free to jump in if I miss anything. So the two programs specifically that Casey had mentioned aren't particular, they're not like mental health focused, but they do, there are areas to kind of, since both of them are mentorship programs, and earlier we kind of talked about how important mentors are. And so I think those two programs are really provide a lot of opportunities for, they're both catered towards high school students. So I should probably start by explaining what they actually are before I start going into the other stuff. But so SREI, is our summer research program. It basically is aiming to provide research experience to high schools. And the goal is to aim towards high schools that don't have access to a lot of research experience, since there are a lot of high schools that are very, you know, underfunded or just don't have access to opportunities nearby that allow for free research opportunities. And so that's what SREI is trying to do. It's held over the summer. Everyone is assigned a mentor, and everyone is able to just get, you know, dip their toes into water about, you know, research and getting to know about the mentors as well, and getting to really form those relationships. And then the second program that Casey mentioned is our CHAMP program. That's also for high schoolers. Again, also trying to serve underserved populations. So again, high schools that are, we try to aim for high schools that again are perhaps maybe lacking in resources or opportunities for mentorship programs. And essentially we just provide free workshops about maybe a resume building, finding mentors to talk about like how to apply for college, or maybe just, you know, having a friend even. Since we are a clinic, we also do like pre-health advising, obviously not to the same extent as like actual pre-health advisors, but sort of like providing experience for some of our pre-med people. We provide a lot of mentorship opportunities for high school students. That, albeit not directly related to mental health, I think provide a lot of opportunities for those conversations to be had, just like, you know, the one we're having right now.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you guys so much for saying that. And Nima, I think that connects definitely to, you know, having a mentorship kind of program with, for the individuals that don't really feel that they can talk to their parents, right? Or maybe even trying to figure out how do I kind of bring up this conversation? They can go to the mentors just for a little bit of guidance, right? That's beautiful. That's awesome. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here as we close out. Whoops. There we go. Okay. Sorry about that. Technical difficulties here.
Can I also share
yes,
the other resources we have?
Please do.
Do you mind if I share screen?
Oh yeah, no, go for it. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. Okay, now you share yours.
Okay, so we got some flyers here. So we have community health and mental health services. And then we provide short-term and individual counseling. And then we provide case management, benefit enrollment, such as Medi-Cal and food stamps and other resources like that. And then we provide workshops, health education, and advocacy and other case management. And then, like I said, for our youth program, we have academic and after school tutoring, leadership development. We also have mentoring and extracurricular activities. And then in our civic engagement and immigration program, we have, of course, community and civic engagement, advocacy, leadership, immigration referrals and citizenship services, interpretation and translation in English, Cambodian, Khmer, and Spanish, and then also health and mental health advocacy and cultural competency training. And then on the left is one of our programs that we've been funded for about COVID-19. We provide individual peer support counseling for all ages and group support for all ages. And then we provide outreach and engagement connection to resources for all ages as well to support during this pandemic time.
Michael, that is wonderful. That is wonderful. Thank you for sharing. I also noticed that you guys have different phone numbers for languages, which is awesome. So they can call.
Yeah, we do.
No, that's beautiful. That's awesome. Great. Definitely making it easier for individuals to engage, right, with the resources. So that's awesome. Great. Okay. Would you guys like to share your screen before I close us out for the night? Or are you all good with sharing your resources? All good. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the thumbs up. All right. So here we are. And we just shared a little bit about our resources. Thank you everyone for doing so. And Ocapico, we also dropped their resources in the chat room. Thank you to Amanda. And then I just wanna go ahead and talk about our survey. So being that we have these virtual webinars and our other signature programs here at NAMI, all at no cost, we do ask that you complete our survey here, being that your feedback is really appreciated. The county allows us to kind of create these events to engage with the community, especially for teens and young adults. And Honest Hour is just one way for us to really dig deep into these conversations. And so with the feedback, we're able just to kind of let the county know what worked, what didn't work, right? Also for us here at NAMI, we would like to see what you guys like to engage with. And so with that being said, please feel free to fill out that survey. It's gonna take about 5 minutes and yeah, I would love to see what you guys thought of today's event. And I will also be sharing the feedback with Michael, Neiman, and Casey as well. So we can just kind of look through what you guys have thought. All right, and now upcoming events real quick. Let's just kind of go through these. On this coming Friday, actually, we have video games and mental health. So this is going to be a conversation where we're discussing video games in the sense of the community, right? Language use, gender roles, right? Mental health, unhealthy habits, or even healthier habits. But it's going to be similar to this Honest Hour, more of a discussion, right? But it's going to be between gamers. So that it'd be interesting just to kind of see how their experience has been. And then of course, on the 25th, we're gonna go ahead and close out our 4-part Wellness Through Creativity and Skill Building workshop with Turning Your Passion into Purpose. So Rami's gonna join us. He is the founder of Fashionatomy, which is, the story is so amazing. Honestly, when I met with him via Zoom, I was inspired the entire time. But basically, he created these abstract designs for necklaces. And there's one of a brain, there's one of a seahorse, but the seahorse looks like an ear. And the whole point of his whole line is to bring awareness to chronic illnesses and to mental health conditions. And with that being said, someone could easily see you in the store and say, whoa, what is that on your necklace? And that's just a conversation starter. And that brings in, the conversation around mental health. And then we're just, slowing down the stigma around it, which is beautiful. And that's, really our mission here. So please join us for that conversation. And of course, we have our last happy hour of this month, which will be next Friday, and that is TikTok recipes. So I don't know about you guys, but I've heard of the whipped coffee. We're also going to be doing the feta pasta. So a lot of fun things. There's also going to be vegan options. So we're pretty much just going to be watching one of our interns here at NAMI kind of speed, creating all these different recipes with her roommate. So that'll be a lot of fun. It'll be kind of like a vlog style. But yeah, a lot of fun things coming up. Actually, here are the flyers, just so you can kind of have a visual of the video games here on the left side. And we got the TikTok recipes, and that is Rami right there at the bottom. Fashionatomy is his brand. So it's going to be really, really exciting. And I look forward to seeing you all there. We do have all of our events on our NAMI-OC events.eventbrite.com page. You can find everything there, all at no cost. And I do believe we have Brianne here to talk to us about face-to-face. So I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing my screen so she can let you all know about our amazing new program.
Yeah. Oh, there we go. Hello, I'm Brianne. I'm a mentor for the new face-to-face program. This is a new program that focuses on making connections and providing emotional support to the residents of OC. Face-to-face is a 6-week long mentorship where individuals will be paired with a trained NAMI mentor and will meet weekly over Zoom. This will be to those 16 and older. We have trained mentors that are close in age and have similar experiences. They'll be able to connect and relate to you. What we discuss is completely up to you, and we're just there to give you support and resources that you need. If you are interested in signing up or would like to know more, you can go to our website, namioc.org/face-to-face. You can find the link in the chat box. I'm pretty sure it'll be dropped there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Brianne. And I love your happy hour hoodie. I have the same one. Yes. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. Beautiful. So other than that, I think we're all set for the night, guys. But for the face-to-face program, please check it out. I personally was a peer connector and that was over the phone. So, I mean, I would love to be in face-to-face where I could just hop on Zoom and kind of talk to you, you know, on a weekly basis, but really just that emotional support, right? You know, we were kind of talking about connecting with our parents and kind of being uncomfortable. What if they see us as weak? Well, call Brianne, you know, call your face-to-face connector. And from there, no judgment, right? You know, just trying to be there to support you. So that's a great program. And other than that, it's been amazing connecting with you all. Michael, Casey, Neiman, I wish I could give you guys a hug. We're going to have to do this in person one day, but amazing conversation. And I'm just so thankful for you all. And I'm so thankful for the organizations that you guys work with. Other than that, I look forward to connecting with you all, and we will see you guys on Friday for video games and mental health, because who doesn't want to talk about video games and mental health, right? All right, have a good night, guys. And if you eat some of that food, take a picture, send it to NAMI-OC so we can see what it looks like. Give us a rating, all that. All right, take care, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.